And now here from the press conference for Beauty and the Beast, Michael Stott, the managing director, makes his first introductory remarks. The artistic director, Mark S. Hobie, introduces the musical numbers, which is Belle, with the entire company. Then If I Can't Love Her with the Beast, Tally Sessions. A Change in Me, sung by Belle with their father, Joe Bloom, there. To Be Human Again. And then I got interviews with Belinda Allen, Stacia Fernandez, Stephen Mark Lucas, Gavin Lee, Kevin Curtis, Joel Bloom, Janelle Chu, Tana English, Kevin Legan, Alex Sanchez, and it was filmed at the new 42nd Street Studios, and you've only got till July 3rd in which to see this wonderful Beauty and the Beast at the Paper Mill Playhouse.
It's really thrilling to return to this show at this point. The material is so rich. I really think that the heart of this show is so moving and compelling, and we have an incredible company here today who you're going to meet in just a few moments. We're going to show you four segments from the show. As you know, it takes place in an enchanted castle, but it first begins in a little provincial village somewhere in France. And we're going to show you the opening number, which is entitled Belle, and this is our Belle, who's Belinda Allen. The company will take their places. We'll begin right at the top of the opening number. Thank you and enjoy. Selection from the end of the If I Can't Love. He said we'll go right from change in me.
We're finally home. Past here.
I don't know what happened. The last thing I remember, I was falling and...
You were in the woods, Papa. I thought I'd never find you.
The beast, how did you escape?
Just a few weeks ago.
And you played all the parts in that one, didn't you?
I did. I covered. I understudied the three women in the show.
Yep. Well, how could you learn all three women's lines? And plus, Belle, you're the lead here. You had to do songs, dance. Oh my God, your brain, the capacity for actors and their brains just amazes me.
Thank you. It definitely takes a certain mind shift to cover roles, and our swings here in Beauty and the Beast are amazing. So they've already jumped in for different tracks, and it's really exciting to see.
And it must be fun, you know, because the Beast, he's supposed to be so, but he's kind of furry and cuddly.
I know. Well, definitely I get to see the, he's frightening at first, but then, yeah, there's that, the endearing quality of some, what they call a monster, but really they're actually very sweet. And so I'm excited to see all the costumes and everything.
I know, and you get to dance with like chandeliers and, you know, candelabras.
Yes.
and wardrobes. I mean, the cutlery alone was so, that just was like eye-popping.
I know, and you didn't even get to see Be Our Guest, which is amazing. So I'm excited for you to see that.
I don't know how you can sing with your jaw open all the time.
I know. It's- definitely smiling from ear to ear the whole time, for sure.
And it's such a lovely part because, you know, it shows, this is one of the best, this was like the first Disney film that totally showed women, you know, that we could be smart and pretty and we could be our own person. This was like a breakthrough.
Absolutely, yeah. Belle was my first favorite Disney princess and I loved to read as a kid and it was so exciting to see a girl who stood up for herself and she liked to read, but she was the heroine and not made fun of. Even though she was made fun of at the beginning, she found her strength despite of that and because of that. So it's really an honor to bring that character to life.
And also it shows she's not superficial. She does not go for the handsome guy, but the handsome inside guy.
Exactly, yes. It's all about what's inside.
Yes. Well, congratulations on your promotion.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
They are with
Stacia Fernandez playing Mrs. Potts at Paper Mill Playhouse.
Beauty and the Beast.
That's right. That's right. Beauty and the Beast. This is the third production of Beauty and the Beast I've done. The first one was on the national tour. The second one was on Broadway. And this is my third.
What parts did you play in all of them?
Well, when I started with the show, I was very young, and I played the egg timer. And then when I moved to Broadway, I played the flower vase, and I understudied Mrs. Potts and the wardrobe. And I became a vacation swing for the Broadway company, and I ended up taking over for Mrs. Potts for a while. I like to say I was the world's youngest Mrs. Potts, which is not the case anymore. Now I'm completely age-appropriate.
So which utensil did you like the best?
Well, you know what? There's a utensil, there's a little piece of the numbered Be Our Guest, and it's the salt and pepper shakers. They fly through the air with the greatest of ease. They're beautiful dancers, and Alex has done an amazing job choreographing that number.
Well, you expect salt and pepper shakers to shake it up.
That's right. Shake, shake, shake.
That's right.
So you get to play, you get to sing that wonderful song.
I sing the title song. Which is Beauty and the Beast, and it's the moment when the audience truly knows that Belle and the Beast have fallen in love, and I get to sing it as a lullaby to my son, Chip.
I know, Mrs. Potts is such a maternal character.
Yes, Mrs. Potts takes care of everyone. She makes Belle, after the Beast steals her and pulls her into the castle, she makes sure that Belle understands that she has a support team. And I really take care of her and try to keep everybody moving in the right direction while serving an amazing cup of tea.
We love tea and sympathy.
That's right. Tea and sympathy from Mrs. Potts, dear.
And also you take care of all the other poor, unfortunate humans that are half forced to be wardrobes and stuff. You give them, like, optimism. You're an eternally optimistic character.
Yes, I'm always bubbling and brewing. Mrs. Potts is always keeping a smile on her face and trying to keep everyone moving forward. Absolutely.
Well, it looks lovely and enchanting, and yes. I can't wait to see it. Thank you. Did you have to work out to get this part? I mean, you're really pumped up.
Well, you know, I tend to play a lot of parts like this, so I try to keep in shape as best as I can in between jobs, so I'm always ready for the next, you know, opportunity. Yeah.
That must be hard, though.
It is, and this role is very, deceivingly very physical. You know, I'm lifting a lot of people. I throw girls up in the air and Gaston, the number Gaston, and I lift Belle over my shoulder, and I dance a little bit, and so it's good. You know, it's definitely giving me a workout.
Don't you have to lift two women at once at one point?
I lift two women at one point. I throw a girl over my head at another point. So, yeah, I fight with a sword. You know, it's a challenge, but it's, you know, it's a lot of fun. It's keeping me in good shape.
You also carry animals and dead beasts around.
That's right, yeah.
Just an all-around good guy, aren't you?
Yeah, well, I don't know if I'd call Gaston a good guy, but you know, he has reasons for everything that he does, and, you know, he's, it's fun to be the antagonist in a show for a change, you know?
And to be so self-absorbed. I mean, yeah. It's like you have such wonderful focus because you can focus on how wonderful you are. Yes,
yeah, it goes against my nature as a person, but it is fun to sort of indulge in that for a little while, yeah.
It's a wonder you could even fall in love with a female because you're so in love with yourself.
Well, yeah, I think he, I do think he loves himself, but I think it, you know, it comes from a place of insecurity. So I think that, you know, he's really looking for the same thing that Belle and the Beast are, which is, you know, to find that connection and to find that safe home, you know?
It's hard to tell with all the bluster.
Yes, of course, of course, of course. You'd never know. You'd never know that just looking at him, of course. Yeah.
Well, enjoy. I can't wait to see. It's going to be so much fun.
Thank you. I'm very excited. Very excited to get out to paper mill and get the show on the road. Yeah.
Thank you. Here we are with...
I'm Gavin Lee. I play Lumiere.
You poor fella. First you have four legs and now you don't have any arms. I mean... You miss being a human more than the other characters on this show. That song must really resonate for you.
It really does. I've had a nice run of characters that are not human beings, including the Grinch at Madison Square Garden. So, yeah, when will I get to be a human again? But I don't mind because I'm also having a nice run of shows where my kids can come and see it. And it's totally appropriate for them to come. So they're gagging to come and see Beauty and the
Beast. How old are they?
My kids are 8, 6, and 2.
They are beyond perfect, especially for SpongeBob.
Oh, yeah, SpongeBob and Grinch. And now my 2-year-old's even going to come to this. There's an autism performance we're doing, a matinee. And we're like, well, that's going to be a loud performance, so my 2-year-old can come and make as much noise as she wants, because she'll be shouting daddy a lot, I think.
Well, New Victory also has autism performances, so you can take your kid to those, too.
Yeah, we've been to a performance there before, yes.
So, is it hard to dance without your arms? I mean, and also with the four legs. I still can't get over that tap dance. It was the most phenomenal thing I ever saw.
Well, no, yeah, it's either my legs have extras or my hands have extras. With this show, I'm not dancing too much, but whenever I do a spin or something, that extra weight does really get you off balance on your hands. So, and also I'm hitting a lot of people, like in the big production numbers like Be Our Guest and Human Again. I'm waltzing around with the Babette, and occasionally I'm whacking people because these candlesticks are just so big. So it's just about navigating. When we get into tech starting tomorrow, I'll be able to navigate my paths so I'm not trying to clobber someone on the head with a candlestick.
That's true. All the characters, they have such a different space around them that it's like you're learning dancing steps plus keeping your space to yourself. That's really complicated.
It is true, but the choreographer and assistant, they've just been so good in making sure we're all safe all the time. Because also, all the guys have these big knives and forks and spoons sticking out of their head as well. And so it's not just the inanimate objects like Madame La Grande Bouche and Mrs. Potts and Cogsworth and myself. It's the whole ensemble during Be Our Guest. I've got these big costumes with big extras as well. So we're just going to be very safe, take it very slow in tech, and I'm sure we're all going to be fine and just love doing the show.
I'm also curious, because I was thinking about this when I was looking at the costumes, because it's a Disney show. Do they provide you the costumes, or can you be creative and make new costumes every time they do a show?
Well, these costumes, a lot of them have been made brand new, but also none of these costumes are the same design as the original Disney Broadway show. So someone along the way redesigned a whole new kind of idea and set of costumes. And a lot of our costumes have been hired from other big productions of Beauty and the Beast, and a lot have been made brand new.
Oh, so it'll be fun to try to spot them.
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Well, congratulations. It looks like so much fun.
This is a really fun show. I mean, this score, we all kind of grew up listening to this fabulous score, a score by Alan Menken, and I'm just happy to be listening to it every night in the wings.
And it's so nice. And also, it gives us a whole new look at, like, now when we look at candelabras and wardrobes, we can imagine them as real things.
That's right. Of course, because since it opened on Broadway many years ago, after the cartoon, you then have the live version of Beauty and the Beast that came out in the movies a few years ago. So it's back on everyone's minds, and everyone knows these songs again. The younger generation are now getting to learn it. My 2-year-old has had the cartoon on at home for the last month, playing it every single day. So my 2-year-old is already singing Beauty and the Beast and Be Our Guest. And so she's going to explode when she sees Daddy on stage singing the songs that she's listening to at home on the movie.
I bet she'll sing along.
She certainly will. She will not be quiet. There'll be a lot of pointing and daddy, daddy, and my wife going, shh.
Actually, you know, you just made me realize it's sort of like a rock concert for little kids.
Well, it certainly is. Any of the fabulous Disney cartoons that are musicals that have been made into stage shows, for kids that watch them over and over again on video or on DVD at home, it's so brilliant that then you can bring them to the theater and they know the story, so they're already engaged and they're waiting to see how it's going to be different on the stage compared to the version that they watch at home on the TV.
This is generational because it's been around long enough that now parents are bringing their kids to something they loved as a kid.
Exactly. I mean, I'm sure some of the original boys that played Chip on Broadway, you know, they're probably like 40 by now.
That's true.
Yeah.
Well, enjoy.
I'm certainly going to enjoy myself. Come and see us at Paper Mill.
Thank you. Here we are with
Kevin Curtis.
And you play?
I play LeFou.
The sidekick of Gaston.
Gaston's sidekick. Yeah, it's so exciting.
How can you put up with him? He's so horrible.
I mean, we all love Gaston, right? That was the only one that doesn't. She's weird.
He's so abusive towards you.
He's so abusive, but LeFou doesn't see it as abuse. You know, he sees it as getting closer and having fun with his friend.
How did he become friends with Gaston in the first place, I wonder? I'm sure you have a backstory in your mind.
Oh, absolutely. Like, I feel like LeFou is just one of those people that really likes power, and he loves attention, too. So he's going to align himself with Gaston because he has all the power and he gets all the attention.
Oh, he's like the perfect wingman.
He's like the perfect wingman, exactly. He's going to tell you everything you want to hear. You know, he's going to help you do all your dirty work.
And also, you can get his leftover girls.
Exactly. You know, it comes with a lot of currency. Oh. You know, being the sidekick of, you know, the popular guy in town.
I know. This is the first time a sidekick in a Disney film is a human being and not like a parrot or an umbrella.
Oh, well, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because you have to, like, you know, skirt that line, right? Because it's still comedy for kids, but, like, the adults have to enjoy it too, right?
Well, the adults all saw it as a kid, so they're all still going to enjoy it.
Exactly, yeah. Especially if you're in my generation, you're going to love it.
And also, you actually have the best part because you're the comic part. And people always love the comic part. You probably will get the biggest applause at the end because the comic guy always does.
Look, here's hoping. What's funny is this is new for me. I usually don't do comedy. I usually don't do physical comedy. But, like, I've been able to really rely on my dance training. You know, to, like, help me through those physical bits and to really, like, go through that, yeah.
Oh, so you start off as a dancer?
Yeah, actually, the last show I did at Paper Mill was a Chorus Line. I played Richie.
Oh, you were Richie, the guy from Buffalo?
No, Richie's from Missouri, I think.
Richie's the Buffalo guy.
Buffalo. Wait, who's from Buffalo? I don't even remember.
Remember It's Redundant to Kill Yourself in Buffalo?
Oh.
My favorite line, because I'm from near Buffalo. That's my hometown.
That's Bobby. Bobby is from Buffalo. You're testing my Chorus Line knowledge right now. Yeah, Bobby's from Buffalo. Richie is from Herculaneum, Missouri.
Oh. Mm. What happens to Richie in Chorus Line?
Richie gets the show. Yeah.
Okay, and who's the one that gets his knee hurt?
That's Paul.
Okay.
Yeah, well, okay, so my understanding is, like, Richie gets it because Paul gets hurt. I mean, that's how I've always played it, but, you know.
So you're always playing kind of devilish, underhanded characters because you're kind of like a little wicked twinkle in your eye.
Look, I sneak in there at the right time. I'm an opportunist.
Oh, good for you. And what better place than that Paper Mill Playhouse?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this place is iconic. It's great. I'm so excited.
Well, congratulations and yay for you.
Thank you so much.
Here we are with
Joel Blum.
I gotta tell you, my favorite Candor and Ed will always be Steel Pierce.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, that was a really wonderful show, and I was so happy to be a part of it. Yeah,
you were great in it. I just loved it. I just remember you had this wonderful dance number.
Yes. The opening, actually, with Valerie Wright and I, she was my partner, and it was about the marathon dances, so we were partners all through the whole play until in the second act my character has a nervous breakdown. It was pretty great role.
But now you get to play the father, Maurice, in Beauty and the Beast.
That is correct, yes. Yeah, he's an inventor, kind of a sort of an absent-minded professor, and loving father of Belle. He's a single dad also, so they have a real great connection. And especially because the town kind of thinks he's an odd fellow and thinks she's odd because she reads books. So it's kind of fun to play the two odd ones who are practically actually more normal than everybody else.
Which is probably why you get along so well with the Beast, because he's an outsider as well.
Well, yes. I mean, I learned to get along with him. You know, he scares me. But when I see that my daughter, you know, Belle
sees him for who he is, it affects me, and so we're in it together.
And if you hadn't gotten lost and your horse hadn't, like, thrown you, the whole story would never have happened. So you are pivotal to the Beast becoming what he is and Belle finding happiness.
That's right. Thank goodness for the absent-minded lost people in the world.
Because that's how you win in the end.
Yes, that's right. Yes, we...
How you get found. How lost people get found.
That's true. And I think it's one of the messages in the show, you know, that you have to not be afraid to go out there into the woods and, you know, and try to find, you know, the thing that you love. And sometimes the very most unlikely thing is... you know, fulfills that, so it's great.
So you should always be aware of everything that's around you.
Yes, and not be afraid. Not be afraid to venture out and to go where your heart takes you. And it's so exciting to be a part of this production. I remember when it first came out, I was very lucky because I was working a lot back then, so I never even got a chance to see the original production.
Oh, wow.
And so now I'm in it and I've discovered it. I'm overwhelmed. By the end, I'm in the wings ready to take the bow that we just staged, and I'm, you know, tearing up. It's really a beautiful musical. It really is. Family members that actually, I'm from San Francisco originally. Even though I've been in New York for a very long time, I still have my family out there. And they're coming over to see this specifically, which they don't always come to shows where, you know, that aren't exactly on Broadway, but I'm asking them to come to see this because they're going to love it.
Because this is so special, especially the paper mill. They always do such a beautiful job.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, this is my first time working at paper mill, and I've always wanted to work there. I've always enjoyed their productions, and yeah. So this is a, you know, really great thing. And also, you know, Mark Hobie, the director, he and I did, I hope he doesn't mind my saying this, he and I did Singing in the Rain together at the Darien Dinner Theater way, way back in the 80s. And he played Don, and I played the Donald O'Connor part.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Yeah,
so it was, and when I walked in the audition, there he was, I went, oh my gosh, how are you, you know, and so this has been kind of a reunion for us as well. It's been fun.
Oh, you must have been like trading old stories together.
Yeah, well, he's been pretty busy with the whole company, but yes, it's you know, there's a lot of years between then and now, that's for sure.
Well, congratulations. I can't wait. It's so exciting.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure. My pleasure.
Thank you. Are with
Janelle Chu.
And you play
Babette.
And who is Babette in this?
Babette?
Yes.
She's one of the maids in the castle, and she...
Is she a real maid, or is she like a feather duster or something?
Now she's a feather duster, unfortunately, because of the spell. I turn into feather duster, and as the play goes on, I get more feathery and more feathery, and yeah.
Oh, you're like Ginger Rogers outfit and Cheek to Cheek, that whole feather.
Ah.
Oh, Fred Astaire hated it because it was all feathers, and they kept flying all over the place of feathers. So do your feathers stay on?
I think they're going to stay on.
So they're not ruffled.
No. No, yeah. They'll be down below and I'll have some on my hands because they're growing everywhere.
Is it fun dancing as a not a human being?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm not a dancer and I don't have a lot of dance experience. So even the little bit that I'm doing, I'm having a lot of fun. It's really hard, but it's good. But I'm wearing a very tight mermaid style to kind of like mimic that kind of feather dustery look, and so yeah, but I'm having fun.
And you get to be a sexy feather duster.
Yes, first and foremost, it's a sexy. yes.
Well, I'm sure everyone is just excited you got this part and can't wait to see you in it because it's such a great show.
Yes, it's a great show. I've never seen the production of it. I had only watched the movies growing up, which I loved and listened to every day after school. So the fact that I get to be in it now is, it's a dream come true. It's great.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Here we are with
Donna English
at the Paper Mill Playhouse, which is basically your second home because how many shows have you done it? How many times have I interviewed for Paper Mill Playhouse?
Well, you know, I counted this time as I was putting my bio together. 10. This is
is my 10th show.
Lucky 10.
It is, and I feel so honored. It's like home. Like, I know all the crew are fantastic, you know. I know they've been there forever, like I have been. Now, it was 10 shows over probably a 25-year period, so, you know, every couple of years, I am so blessed to get to come back to Paper Mill.
Yeah, because you sneak off to Good Speed and you do it at Encores at City Center. You're all over the place. And we should say who you're playing.
I am Madame de la Grande Bouche, who means Madame of the Big Mouth. And I'm an opera singer who is stuck somehow. I think there singing that night that the curse was cast on the spell was cast on the castle. And I have now become a huge wardrobe. And so I am... you know, stuck inside of this wardrobe with just my head and my arms and legs out.
That must be hard to act as with your whole body so constricted.
Well, it is, but you know what? It's also, it's really good for the character because that's our problem. We're all, you know, we have a song called Human Again where we're dreaming of just only being human because right now we're part inanimate objects and part human, you know? And so we want to be free from this constraint. And so there's not a lot of acting involved because I want to be free from this huge, heavy wardrobe. But it's fun. It looks great. And
that's one thing. That's one diet that'll work because as soon as you're human again, you lose all that weight.
I know. We've been saying that the minute we take off our costumes here in the run-throughs, we're like, I feel so thin now. I feel so light. And I think I may lose some weight because it's kind of foam-lined on the inside. So, you know, it may be a great kind of sweat-it-off kind of weight loss thing for me.
So what kind of character is the wardrobe? Is she like haughty? Is she nice? Is she naughty? Is she full of spice?
I would say haughty probably is of all of those choices. She's pretty haughty. You know, she's an opera singer and so she longs to perform and I think that is her main focus and it's really fun because it's I get to use and add in a lot of little vocal leases and like trills and things that are not in the script, but that I add as she's speaking, and that's been really fun to find those.
So this is a great singing part to get.
It is, actually. It is. And a lot of her singing takes place within scenes, you know, where I just suddenly sing a line that's written.
It's like the King Lear of musicals.
Oh, well, I don't know if we go that far, but she could certainly handle King Lear, probably, you know?
That's what we need next, a musical King Lear.
Yes, that would be very interesting, but played by a woman.
But like Glenda Jack?
Yes, exactly.
But you would play it because you have the voice and she doesn't.
Well, there you go. Maybe in a few years, you know, that'll be my destiny. Thank you for putting that in my head.
My pleasure. But for now, let's stick to going to see Beauty and the Beast at the Paper Mill Play.
Yes, really, really. Everybody come. It's a fantastic, fantastic cast. Oh my gosh. This is a beautiful, beautiful production.
Yeah, not a beast among them.
No.
Oh, beauties.
They are. They are, actually. Very humble, fantastic people.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Good to see you again.
Good to see you again, too.
We are with...
Kevin Ligon. I play Cogsworth.
The clock.
The clock. Oh. He's becoming a clock. He's not completely a clock, but mostly a clock.
So you play a very timely character.
Yes. Oh. Yes, I do. He's very timely.
And you're not... But you're not one of the second banana, though.
Well, sort of. I mean, yeah, I guess sort of. The Cogsworth and Lumiere and Mrs. Potts, they're sort of like the second bananas in a way. I don't know.
I was going for seconds. You know, sorry, bad pun. So, what's it like dancing and singing as a clock?
Well, it's hot because I have the actual part of the costume, the bulkiest part of the costume I've been wearing here in the rehearsals, and it's, I think you heard Donna saying it's sort of made of foam, so it gets pretty hot, so that's what it's like. You're trying to act like it's not hot, but it is, and you know, it's fun. This show is just so fun.
It's beloved by one and all, by kids and grown-ups alike. Yeah. And does the clock go the whole time, the whole secondhand? Is it constantly in motion? I noticed that.
No, it actually, I have a little button, don't tell anybody, that controls it and that makes it go around, but we're only going to use that sparingly. It's mostly not moving at all. So
I just was letting the people with vertigo know that one.
Yeah, it won't move all the it mostly sits stationary. I mean, actually, what I've been wearing in the rehearsal is not the piece that I'll be wearing out of Paper Mill. They're sort of made from the same mold, I think you would say, but...
Yeah, rehearsal gadgets.
Yeah, well, these are, I think it was used in a previous production somewhere, made by the same people that made the costume that I will be wearing, which I'll find out tomorrow what that will actually be. But it'll be very, very similar and operate in the same way, you know, and fit me hopefully in the same way.
Yeah, this is a tricky role because, you know, you have to be able to learn to sing and act and dance in a costume, like one of those mascots, yeah. You know, so that's tricky.
Yeah, it's kind of also like, way back when in college I did mask work, it's sort of like that, or maybe like puppet work a little bit, but it's really about sort of transcending the costume, working through the costume, or if you're wearing a mask, working through the mask, and there's a technique to that, actually, but we don't often get to employ it in this business, but it's been fun to kind of return to that a little bit.
And you get to play a Kvetty character.
Yes, yes, he's quite tightly wound, so to speak, and it's fun, you know, it's a really great character. It's really well written, and mainly I just love being out there with Gavin playing Cogsworth and
yeah, you like Laurel and Hardy.
Yeah, we're bouncing off each other, so to speak, and that's a joy because, as you know, he's the best. So, you know, can't argue with that.
And so are you.
Oh, thank you so much.
Well, enjoy and congratulations.
Oh, thanks a lot. I hope you get to be out and see it soon. Everybody, come see it at Paper Mill.
Yeah, it's a gorgeous theater.
Yes, absolutely gorgeous.
Thank you. We are with
Alex Sanchez.
Who choreographed this? So I'm curious, how do you choreograph people in these things that are just not, you know, they ruin people's balance, you know, to be in these big, gigantic costumes, and yet they have to dance, and you have to be able to make them steps that they can do while carrying such heavy weights. This is so complicated. How do you do this? I'm fascinated.
Well, a lot of planning ahead, of course. Secondly, the dancers are very strong. They have a very, very strong core, so their balance is incredible. But you do have to choreograph specifically for what their costume is. For instance, I have these ladies in plates, and so the plates conjure to me very showgirl choreography, and so they do what you would think of like Las Vegas showgirl type of movement. Salt and pepper shaker, the two salt and pepper shaker have these costumes that remind me very much of the traditional Russian Cossack dancers, because it's very baggy and they have these hats and everything. And so I choreographed that kind of movement for them, Russian Cossack, where they're jumping and turning, you know, and they're able to emulate that style of dancing with their costume. The utensils are more, for me, like waiters, because they have these costumes that are very erect and straight, and so it makes me think of waiters, you know, like from Guys and Dolls.
Yeah.
Not Guys and Dolls, Hello Dolly. Yeah. So it makes me think of waiters, and so the movement that I gave them was that kind of, you know, that kind of movie you see, like
posture.
That kind of posturing, like Mame and Hello Dolly, and that kind of style of Broadway dancing for them. So each costume provides a different element of movement that coincides with what they're wearing. Yeah.
So what does Lumiere and Cogswell suggest?
Lumiere is great because, first of all, we have Gavin, who's an incredible dancer, and so for him, he does a lot of posturing, but he's very mobile, and so I made him into like a Fred Astaire type character, where he does a lot of like soft shoe and quick footwork. Yeah, very elegant. He's also very tall, and reminds me a lot of Dick Van Dyke in a way, so I gave him a lot of movement that you would see like Dick Van Dyke do as well. So there's a lot of, you know, soft shoe. There's a soft shoe for him. There's waltzing for him. There's like these elegant turns that he does because he's got these big candelabras that he's holding. So there's a lot of beautiful sort of posy turns that he does with them as well. And in terms of like someone like Cogsworth, who is not really involved with the numbers a lot, it's just basically, you know, using his body for swaying. Characters like him and Mrs. Potts and those characters are more about angles and sways and those kinds of movement for them. Yeah.
Well, I can't wait to see it all. It's fascinating. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
And I saw your...
Oh, you did?
Caught in San Francisco.
Oh, wow, that's so cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was a fun project.
It was beautiful.
Yeah,
it was oh, my God, those Cole Porter's numbers.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I had a lot of fun with that. Thank you.
You're welcome.
It's yours.